So I want to talk about a mathematical idea of diffusion. Let me start by giving some sort of rough definition of what I understand by a diffusion process. And the definition I'm going to give is that this diffusion process is a process where you have a variable that can be a density, a temperature, the price of a stock, or whatever, that sort of tries to revert to its surrounding average. In other words, if what's around it is higher density, then the density will increase. If what surrounds you is lower density, the density will decay. So, oops, what happened? So what basically I will try to show you how to start with a simple example as the basic idea and then see how this idea becomes more complex and becomes involves different areas of mathematics. So it's more like analogy talk. So there are three ideas that I want to track down, which are the ideas of diffusion, of something which I'm going to call gain and loss, and of entropy. So let me start with the most simple and classical example of a diffusion process, which is a random process. In other words, you have a bunch of particles which are jumping left or right with the same probability. So I did this little picture. So suppose you have these three piles of particles, the red particles, and the particles jump right or left with some given probability. Okay, so if that is the case, we can see three things in very, very, very simple processes. The first one is the tendency of the size of each one of the piles to revert to its surrounding. Oops. What happens with this is just changes very fast. Okay. Oop. Come on. That now doesn't work. Oh, okay, let's see. This changes very fast. Okay. Okay. The numbers there is just to show the complexity of the computers nowadays. So the density then evolves to a law that we cannot see that says that the density of the particles changes proportionally, to the number of particles on the right and on the left jumping into the position of the central particle. So these are the gain of particles or the gain of density. And the particles that leave the central pile and move to the other. And so this is the loss of density. Okay, so if you take an infinitesimal version of this, what you get is the classical heat equation. Where do I point? Let me see. I point there. Okay, I point there.
If you use on the table,
it's better.
It's more easy.
Okay, okay. So there are here, this simple process shows the three main features of what I want to describe. There is this tendency of the size of a pile to revert to the surrounding ones. In other words, if you have a long pile in the middle and small ones around, then the larger pile will lose more particles, and this is the gain-loss balance. And also, there is implicit in the process, there is some sort of entropy, and the entropy is what will make the piles flatten with time. In fact, if you start with a bunch of particles and let them go, it will converge to a Gaussian that will expand to infinity. And there is a detailed balance of gain and loss. If the balance between gain and loss, if there is more losses than gains, this is like a death process, and then the density will decay to infinity. If there is a gain, it's like a birth process. And in a process like that, there are a lot of instabilities, like large pair piles try to grow faster than smaller piles and produce singularities. Okay. There is also the concept of entropy in a process like that, which is given by the fact that if you take the density, it's preserved, but if you take any convex function of the density, that will decay to zero with time. Okay. So this same process, which is sort of very simple in this context, appears in many other areas of mathematics. For instance, in a viscous flow, right, what I described before as diffusion is viscosity. The idea in a viscous flow is that you have a particle which is moving together with its flow, and if the surrounding particles are going at higher speed, they drag the particle, they accelerate the particle. And if the surrounding particles are moving slower, then they break the particle. And so the mathematical effect is the same. It's this force in the particle sort of to revert to the speed group, okay? And in this example, for instance, what happens in the Navier-Stokes equation, then the entropy is related to the decay of kinetic energy. In other words, the momentum is preserved, that is, the total average of the velocities of the particles remain constant, but the kinetic energy, which is the square of the velocities, goes to zero. Okay? And of course, the classical example is temperature flow in the heat equation, where basically the same phenomena occurs through Fourier law that says that caloric energy goes from higher to lower temperatures. So a more interesting example concerns non-local diffusion. Suppose you have a population that wants to avoid crowding, but the difference with the particle that only jumps to the next spot, population has global information. In other words, the population knows what is the density of population everywhere else and is willing to move to some positive density. Then the process is still a diffusion process, but it is an integral process. Okay, so in this process, you have your population, the density of population that is sitting at the point X, and it knows what is the density of a population everywhere else. Okay, and puts a weight to the density of a population everywhere else. In other words, puts a weight to the knowledge that the population in position Y is U of Y. It weighs it, it adds up all, in other words, compares itself with everybody around, and then it decides if it's going to move or not. Okay? And so what you have in that case is some sort of integral diffusion process. Still, UT tries to increase if the information around it is bigger, or decrease if information is lower. Okay? And still is this, this idea of reverting to the mean. Non-local diffusion process, for instance, arise in polymer flow, when polymer flow will be the non-local equivalent to viscosity. In other words, when you have the standard viscosity in the Navier-Stokes equation, that's an infinitesimal information. In polymer flow, what you have is that the molecules are of very different length, and therefore, the viscous effect is felt at long distances. In quantitative finance, when you try to sort of predict sort of an option or the value of a stock in the future, and this, you know, if the stock has very tiny movements, then you represent that with a standard diffusion process. But if the stock makes a jump process, then you need to represent it with an integral problem. Okay. Another example is when you have a chemotaxis modeling, or you have a population that creates some sort of chemical field that attracts or repels the particles. If the particles are repelled, then that's a diffusion process. In other words, everything tries to spread around. And then mathematically, this behaves like has a flattening, a smoothing effect. If the potential attracts particles, then this is an anti-parabolic process. It's a process that tends to form singularities and tends to form peaks of population. So the Laplace and related equation, this equation of diffusion, are very old, relatively old. They They were from the beginning of the 18th century and were related to electrostatic potential, incompressible flow, and balance equations. But the one I was into want to discuss today is sort of some areas where this appears in a more subtle way. So I like to give a flavor of how these ideas resurface through sort of curvature in geometry, from propagation in fluid mechanics, phase transition, complex systems, etc. Okay. So some of the examples I want to discuss are, for instance, the edge of a flame, or a fluid or a gas invading a porous medium, or a population expanding or contracting. One of the things I want to point out is that in many of these processes, there is some sort of hysteresis. In other words, when a population expands, then it is a diffusion process, and the advancing front sort of rounds up and has a tendency to smooth itself. When a population contracts, the advancing front is anti-parabolic, it's very unstable, and leaves fingers or aisles below, behind. And the same phenomena cannot be observed in a completely different situation, which is if you take two parallel layers of glass and leave a very small width in between, and you inject fluids, as the fluids advances, then it rounds up and takes a nice shape because it is a parabolic, in some subtle way, it's a parabolic process. While when it recedes, it's formed fingers. Okay, and one way that this is described is through the effect of mean curvature. So let me just give you a little quick cartoon of what mean curvature is. This is what I'm saying already, that diffusion process tends to flatten irregular behavior. So one of the simplest models, I want to talk about in a minute about mean curvature because it's related to this flame propagation. So one of the simplest models for flame propagation says that you have a flame and the edge of the flame advances with a speed proportional to the ignition temperature plus the curvature of the front. So let me tell you what mean curvature is, right? Mean curvature is sort of a geometric version of diffusion. So you have a surface, right? And you take any vertical plane cutting the surface, and you see how the surface bends with respect to the tangent plane. And so in some directions it can bend upwards, and in some directions can bend downwards. And so you average the separation of the surface from the tangent plane, and that's the mean curvature. So for instance, if you have an elastic membrane, then one of the simple models is that it is a surface with zero mean curvature, because the pulling down and the pulling up of the membrane have to balance. Or the same is about the soap film. In the case of a flame propagation, then what happens is the following. You have a front, right? And at each point, the velocity of the front is a combination of some constant or variable quantity that has to do with ignition temperature and the curvature of the surface, which I draw here as a curve. And so as in this picture, I show how, you know, where the curve is curved upwards, then at the beginning comes down, but then as times go by, ends up propagating. And here is where you can see also the parabolic anti-parabolic effect. Because the curvature has a sign implicit there. I'm calling positive curvature sort of the convex curves over the picture. Okay, and if the surface moves proportional to minus that curvature, then it's very unstable and tends to fingering. And that's what happens in the example of the fluids or in the example of the populations contracting. A second example, we are the sort of the diffusive aspect of the problem appears in a more complex way is when you have a solid-liquid interface. In other words, when you have a melting front advancing on a surface. This is a form of surface diffusion. Surface diffusion, for instance, a simple example that you can give of surface diffusion is the following. Suppose you have a domain and you have heat flowing from the right to the left, okay? And all of a sudden you put an insulation wall in between. Okay, then the temperature, you know, is trapped by this thing and it's going to diffuse along the surface. It's going to try to balance itself in some way along the surface. But the balance that the temperature does is sort of a very global and non-local behavior. It's called the Dirichlet to Neumann map. It is a diffusion process because the temperature to average itself around the surface, but it's a diffusion process which is very subtle. And also, this is what happens when you have a melting example. So here I make a little picture. So what happens if the modeling of a melting process, right, has on one side the liquid, and there is heat flow, and there is all the standard components of a heat equation or nonlinear heat equation. In the solid part, also you have that, but when the heat is flowing from heat is flowing from higher to lower temperature, so the heat is flowing through the melting surface. It finds that it has to melt. In other words, have to put an amount of energy to melt in the surface. Okay, and so it produces a phenomena where, it's in some sense, it's like a diffusion process, because if the surface tries to make a finger, you know, the melting area tries to make a finger into the solidification area, it's surrounded by coal, and that takes more and more of the heating energy to melt the surface. So to express that, you know, you take this model and you want to show that this is a diffusion effect, that then if you have a melting surface like that, that the melting surface, you start with any configuration and sort of after a finite time becomes a smooth surface that propagates in a reasonable way, then it is a very subtle mathematical issue that it really forces you to understand in what sense this is a diffusion process. Finally, there is another case of front propagation that has to be with quantitative finance. That is, quantitative finance, when you have an American option, so you are you have an option that you can exert at any moment in time, and you try to model what is your expected payoff at the end of the time. That is like it's a backward diffusion process. In other words, you have the payoff, you know, it's like this is time for me, and I'm the price of a stock, I'm moving randomly, and when I hit the wall, I'm going to be paid some amount. If I'm to the right, I'm going to pay so much. If I'm to the left, I'm going to pay nothing. Okay, and I'm jumping randomly, and so to know what is my expected payoff at this time, what I have to do is I have to start from the final payoff and solve the heat equation backwards. And in an American option, you have the option to stop the process anytime you want. And so that produces an interface between taking the option or not. And so this is again sort of a moving front in space. And here, again, here it's really very important to know where that surface is, you know, because that's where you want to, the moment you cross that surface, you want to exert the option, and to show the stability and to design a good numerical scheme, you really need to understand some sort of implicit diffusion that happens on that surface, and it's a more complex problem. But it is this. The regularization effect on the surface is very much related to this attempt of the surface to average itself. Okay. Let me point out, although I didn't put it here, that is another example of quantitative finance that has a diffusion process in it, and this is the high-frequency trading. High-frequency trading is, I think I understand, it's like 80% of trading bulk nowadays. And what high-frequency trading does is the following. You look at the stock and has sort of a trailing average, okay? And then when the price of the stock sort of separates from the trailing average, then you bet that it's going to go back to the average. In other words, it's reversion to the mean. High-frequency trading plays with sort of the ellipticity of the random process of the stock that will make the value revert to the mean. So let me say a word about gain and loss. So gain and loss, like I mentioned before, is aggregation versus diffusion. So in other words, the gain-loss balance can be unbalanced, and then depending on what wins, the behavior of the process is completely different. For instance, a given population, if you live in New York, then may give, will not want to live in a less populated area. And so when it weights the value of the density of a population somewhere else except itself, it may attribute a negative weight to that. Okay, in other words, to when the population there is smaller than mine, I can give a negative weight to that. And again, that produces sort of a parabolic, anti-parabolic effect. And so the balance of the two preferences can produce very singular equations, and this is a large area of mathematical analysis. And finally, I like to make a few remarks about another process, sort of another level, in some sense another scale of a diffusion process, which is the case of interacting particle systems. And so the most classical example is the Boltzmann equation. The Boltzmann equation models particles which move at a medium density. In other words, if you have the particles which are packed with a high enough density, then you have fluid dynamics. In other words, you have a group velocity and a group density and so on. If you have very few particles, they move like a dynamical system. They never see each other. And Boltzmann equation has to do with the moment in which you have a number of particles which are neither one nor the other. The Boltzmann equation was, until maybe 20 or even 30 years ago, was more like a theoretical equation. But it became very, people became very interested in it about maybe already 30 years ago. The first was with the reentry problem. You know, when you have like the Ariane reentering from, you know, space with almost no particles to the Earth, it crosses a layer where you have this rarefied gas dynamic density. And so at the time, the French created a very strong school in this type of equations. It also became particularly, fashionable or interesting when the size of semiconductors grew small enough that people needed to simulate them with this intermediate density. And so there was a lot of Boltzmann equation work done about semiconductor design. And here, the diffusion process is still present, but in still a much subtler way. So the Boltzmann equation is basically, what it does, it represents there are three independent variables, the position, the velocity, and the time for a particle and says at that position how many particles at time t are going in the direction v. And if the particles will not see each other, then they will just travel in a straight lines. Nobody sees anybody, and it's just a straight lines. And what the Boltzmann equation says is, okay, but they collide from time to time. And so what you have to do when the particles are traveling is you have to keep careful track of, you know, you fix a velocity, a direction, and you have to keep track of which particles after collision take that velocity, and this is your gain quantity. And also you have to take track of the particles that already were traveling in that velocity, and some other particle knock them down. And so you can, if you are careful and laborious, you can, once you decide that, you can write that equation. But there is something very hidden when you write that equation. Because in principle, this is a system of particles and should be completely reversible. In other words, you could say, okay, now I go backwards in time and all the particles come back to their original position. And that's not the case. And the case is something very subtle in the way Boltzmann wrote the equation, which is the molecular chaos hypothesis. And the molecular chaos hypothesis is the diffusion in this process, and simply says that by the time the particles hit each other again, they have forgotten the past. In other words, they are uncorrelated. And this is a very subtle, you know, this from the heat equation to this, there is a world apart. This is a very subtle process. It's very hard to simulate numerically. And this is what gives a sort of entropy decay, that gives diffusion and makes you expect that the solutions will sort of converge to a stationary state, which is Gaussian's. So different versions of the Boltzmann-like equation have been used to describe sand dynamics, you know, like you throw sand into a tube and try to form, like in gas dynamics, try to form a shock, and the simulations are completely different, the shape of the shock and all that. And just to close, let me say that the large-scale simulations have allowed nowadays to sort of improve the precision of many of the problems, like fluid dynamics, in elasticity, in many, or in finance. And at the basis of many of the numerical schemes, there is always a little bit of diffusion. And a little bit of, for instance, Monte Carlo is a typical diffusion method, as mentioned this morning, where you just throw a bunch of particles and see what they do and do the experiment several times until you get some good statistics. Another typical thing is like vanishing viscosity method. You have a problem where you expect a shock or some discontinuity, and then you put a little bit of viscosity that will enforce the entropy condition and things like that. And there are many, upwinding, there are many numerical schemes that at the bottom of their structure have this diffusion process. And this is all I wanted to say. Thank you.